Morning. And welcome to worship. It is wonderful to be here with all of you this morning on this second Sunday in Lent. All right, not the second Sunday of Lent, because as we march towards Easter morning and Good Friday, we need to remember that Sunday mornings are always remembrances and reenactments of Easter, right, of Jesus rising physically from the dead to bring salvation to the world. Just a few things to share with you this morning as we head into worship. First of all, if you have a special prayer need today, Priscilla Long will be available in the pastor's study after worship. And the pastor's study is through these double doors and then an immediate right. Wednesday night, we are in the second week of Acts in the Essential 100 Bible Reading Plan. Dinner is at 6 with studies for all ages at roughly 6:30. Mark your calendars for March 17th. That's a Sunday. After worship, we're going to be hosting a diaper shower and finger food luncheon for Bobby and Sarah Schluter for the birth of their first child. And all are invited to bring diapers and finger food, and there'll be more information coming out on that. Elders and deacons, this is a reminder that next Sunday after worship is the retreat, and hopefully we'll be done by 4 o'clock, and you'll be getting an agenda either Monday or Tuesday by email, and I'll text you ahead of time so you know to look for that. Then one more item to look up or to mark on your calendar is March 9th. It's a Saturday morning at 9 o'clock. We're going to have a sanctuary cleanup, a deep clean of the sanctuary. We've had some construction projects taking place upstairs to repair the plaster on the roof of Miss Lou's room and the youth room. And that dust has just spread through the entire building. And let's have an all-church cleanup to come in before Easter, get everything cleaned up, and it'd be a lot of fun. Okay. That's all I have for you this morning. Just make sure you read your bulletin. It acts as a newsletter, functionally. So there's a lot of announcements in here. So please make sure you know what's happening. I invite you, as you're able, to stand. If you're able, pass the peace of Jesus to your neighbor and remain standing for the call to worship.
Good morning. Would you join me now in our responsive call to worship from Joel chapter 2? Even now, declares the Lord, return to me with all of your heart, with fasting and weeping and mourning. Return to the Lord your God. Let us worship our God of grace and mercy.
Will you please be seated? In the New Testament letter of Hebrews, in the 10th chapter, we read, since we have confidence to enter the sanctuary by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is through his flesh. And since we have a great high priest over the house of God, let us approach with a true heart and full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. So let's take this biblical guidance seriously, excuse me, as we confess our sins corporately together through the unison prayer of confession. We'll then transition to a time of silent personal confession before receiving the assurance of God's pardon. Will you please pray with me? God of mercy, you sent Jesus Christ to seek and to save the lost. We confess that we have strayed from you and turned aside from your way. We are misled by pride, for we see ourselves pure when we are stained and great when we are small. We have failed in love, neglected in justice, and ignored your truth. Have mercy on us, O God, and forgive our sin. Return us to paths of righteousness, through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. When people of faith are honest and coming before God's throne in a spirit of confession, it's important that we hear the promise of forgiveness, right? That we receive afresh on our ears the assurance of God's pardon. In Paul's letter to the church at Rome, we read, "For those who are baptized in Christ Jesus, there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. Jesus Christ, the same Lord, is Lord of all, and is generous to all who call on him. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven." So, on this beautiful, exceedingly warm winter Sabbath day, let us remember the promises God makes to us in baptism as we celebrate that it is in the Lord Jesus Christ that we are truly a forgiven people. Hallelujah. Amen. Will you please rise as you're able?
You may be seated. At this time, if the children would come forward for the children's message. Guys, today? Good. I've got a question for you. If you were to try to find God or Jesus, yeah, go ahead and sit down. Yep. If you were to try to find God, where might you go? Where might you go to find God?
At the Lord.
To church? Okay, good. Church, yep. Where else might you go to find God?
Church.
Yep, church is a, yep.
Heaven.
Heaven, yep, okay, heaven. Is there any way you think that God could speak to you at Walmart? No. I think if we look, we could probably go and God could speak to us just about anywhere. But the problem is, we tend to be people that are in a hurry. Who likes to go hang out at Walmart?
Me.
Okay, a couple of you. I don't care to. I don't really like going to any stores. But you know where I like to go? I like to go out into the woods. Into the woods, yeah. Oh, yes, like that, just like that. Yeah. And sometimes people like to go and sit at the river and just pray. And sometimes, who here has ever been to a mountain? Who here has seen a mountain? Has anybody ever felt like God was speaking to them when they were at a mountain? Anybody out there? Okay, eight of you. Okay, good. So I think that God is present wherever we go. And if we slow down enough and we ask God, God, would you show yourself to me? He will reveal himself to us. How about tonight, if it's not cloudy and it gets dark out and you go look up, what will you see? Stars?
An airplane and moon.
And an airplane and a moon. Yes. Yep, very good. Do you ever feel like you're really tiny and that God is really big? I feel that way when I look at the stars and when I look at mountains and even sometimes when I just go sit in the woods, because God is so big that he's all around. So I'm going to encourage you sometime this week, take some time and sit down and pray and say, God, would you show yourself to me? All right, because God is here for us. So I've got a little thing from Psalm 19. It says, the heavens declare the glory of God, and the skies proclaim the work of his hands. All right, because God loves you so much, he wants to reveal himself to you in church and even outside of church, because he wants to keep on loving you, which he's going to do, and he wants us to love him in return. Okay, let's bow our heads and close our eyes. Father God, thank you for loving us. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you for this church that we can gather in and worship your name, where we can learn and grow. Thank you for nature, God, where we can go out and we can see you. Thank you for all the many blessings that you bestowed upon us. We ask that you would use us, God, to bring the good news of Jesus wherever we go, for your kingdom's sake and for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. This brings us to our time of corporate prayer, intercessory prayer, and I invite you to please pray with me. Lord God, it is a joy to be able to gather here this morning as your people, as your family, to worship you in all of your fullness, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And Lord, as we gather, we cling to the promise that you made to us, that where two or more are gathered in your name, that you will be present through the power of your Holy Spirit. So God, through your Spirit, we ask that you lift up these prayers and petitions, the singing of praise and glory to your name, the giving, Lord, of our tithe and offering, and the reading and proclamation of your word, and that you will present all of this through your Spirit to the Lord Jesus, who sits at your right hand interceding on our behalf at all times, acting as our great high priest. So, Lord, this morning, we lift up to you the Hannibal Community and First Presbyterian Church, and we offer you, first of all, thanksgiving to be a part of these communities. We thank you, God, that since 1832, you have been alive and present in this congregation, bearing witness to your love, your light, your mercy, your peace, and your joy to the Hannibal community. And we ask, God, that you not let us get complacent, that you keep our hearts on fire for you, and that as we leave here today, that we will just have a burden on our hearts to live as your faithful people, to live as a response to all that you've done for us in Christ Jesus. Help us to be willing and able to give an accounting of the faith in which we have. There are so many people who are sad, who are struggling, who live with various forms of brokenness and have no hope. May we be the ambassadors of Christ, showing them a different way to live. May our lives spark an interest where they ask us, what is it that is so different about you? And then, Lord, give us the words to share our love for you. We lift up to you, God, those who are struggling with various forms of hurt and brokenness in their lives. And Lord, that manifests itself in so many different ways. Sickness and chronic pain, addiction, broken relationships, grief, mourning, underemployment, overemployment. God, there are so many ways that we struggle with this, and we pray, Lord, that you will bring about healing holistically, for you are the great physician. Lord, for those who know you and they run from you, and for those who do not yet know you, we ask, Lord, that you make yourself known in wonderful and powerful and lovely ways, stirring faith in people that they repent of sin and turn to you. We lift up our nation to you, O God, and we pray for all of our elected and appointed leaders, from the President of the United States to local township supervisors and street commissioners. And we ask, God, that in all of these men and women, your spirit will be alive and well and moving, making decisions on our behalf, wise decisions, right, that bring you glory and you honor. We lift up the divisions that are in our land. It seems like we disagree on just about everything, and that we can't even agree to disagree, that if somebody doesn't agree with us, we have to anathemize them. And this has caused great hardship, both in families and in communities, even within local churches. Help us to remember, God, that political treaties and compromises will not bring reconciliation, that they will not bring wholeness and healing. Only by returning to the one whom we've forsaken, our first love, your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, can that which is broken be made whole. Lord, we pray for the world in which we live. There's violence, hunger, bloodshed, animosity, and war on all corners of the world. We pray, Lord, for your peace, which flows through your Son, the Prince of Peace, to prevail, that our hearts all around the world may turn to him, and we may live as one family united in Christ. We are particularly mindful this morning, Lord, of the persecuted church, our brothers and sisters around the world who cannot gather freely as we have this morning, but who risk everything coming together, being taken into custody, having their property sold, having their children taken away and sold into slavery, having limbs removed from their bodies, and even being executed. God, we pray for protection. We pray for strength for those brothers and sisters. But we also pray for those who persecute them, for those who hate them, because those who hate them hate you, and you tell us, Lord, to pray not only for our friends, but for our enemies. Make yourself known to those who persecute you, Lord. Change their hearts. Bring them to repentance and make them a part of our family. Lord, all this we pray in the name of Jesus, as well as everything that has gone unsaid within our hearts. And it is your Son who taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation. Amen.
If you curse me, then I will bless you. If you hurt me, I will forgive. If you hate me, then I will love you. I choose the Jesus way.
First scripture reading today is from Job, and this is God's response to Job, wrapping up at the end of the book. Where were you when I laid the earth's foundation? Tell me if you understand. Who marked off its dimensions? Surely you know. Who stretched out a measuring line across it? On what were its footings set? Or who laid its cornerstone? While the morning stars sang together and all of the angels shouted for joy, who shut up the sea behind the doors when it burst forth from the womb? When I made the clouds its garment and wrapped it in a thick darkness, when I fixed limits for it and set its doors and bars in place, when I said, this far you may come and no farther, here is where your proud waves halt. Can you bind the chains of Pleiades? Can you loosen Orion's belt? Can you bring forth the constellations in their seasons, or lead out the bear with its cubs? Do you know the laws of heaven? Can you set up God's dominion over the earth? Can you raise your voice to the clouds and cover yourself with a flood of water? Do you send lightning bolts on their way? Do they report to you? Here we are. Who gives the ibis wisdom or gives the rooster understanding? Who has the wisdom to count the clouds? Who can tip over the water jars of the heavens when the dust becomes hard and the clods of earth stick together?
I've been reflecting for the last few minutes on the Kids Kirk. And I'm reminded of a television show that used to be on TV years ago. I think it was Art Linkletter, was it? Kids Say the Darndest Things. you never know what they're going to say. Oh, goodness. I learned this week, as I was doing some background reading for the sermon topic for today, which is, hasn't science disproven Christianity? That there is actually a field of science that focuses on the study of vegetables and cultivation. I had no idea. It's called olericulture. Apparently, recent studies in that field have revealed that vegetables react differently to different environments where they're placed due to the stimuli that are around them. For example, one olericulturalist wrote a paper regarding taking a variety of different vegetables and bringing them into a church sanctuary and placing a very powerful microphone next to them. Apparently, it picked up a small voice that said, "Let us pray." And bearing that guidance, let us pray. Lord God, may the meditations of all of our hearts that are here this morning, and may the words that flow from my lips truly be pleasing in your eye. For Lord, you are both our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So we are in the second Sunday of Lent this week as we continue our journey with Jesus from the Mount of Transfiguration to Jerusalem, right, to Maundy Thursday, to Good Friday, and ultimately to Easter morning. During this season of the Greater Church, here at First Presbyterian Church of Hannibal, we are looking at questions that non-believers oftentimes level against Christianity. And they are all good questions that people honestly struggle with pertaining to faith in Jesus and the Lord God. And so if people outside the church have these kind of questions, that tells us that people within the church also have these questions, or at least questions that are similar to them. So the purpose of addressing these questions during Lent on Sunday morning worship is, it's not to make you an expert, because that's just not going to happen in 20 to 25 minutes. But the purpose is to make us familiar with the subject matter so that we can engage in conversation with people when they come to us with honest questions about what the Christian faith is really all about. So in your bulletins, just as last week, there is a white insert. And the front page of the insert says, "Hasn't science disproved Christianity?" And that is the outline I'm going to try to be following for the sermon today, so you're able to follow along. The backside of it, it says, "Great questions about the Christian faith." And it has the different topics that we're going to be looking at. For example, last week on February 25th, I took that off. Last week was February 18th, right? And the topic that Sunday was How do we know that the Bible is reliable? And we looked at the historical background, the creation of the Bible. How did it come together? What texts were chosen? And I know that was a lot coming at you at one time, but I hope that we began to realize that the Bible is one of the most historically reliable books in the history of humankind. We can trust the manuscripts, right? Today, we're going to be looking at, hasn't science disproved Christianity? And then, can't we just be good without God? Doesn't Christianity crush diversity? Well, that's a hot topic today. Can Jesus be true for you, but not for me? And then finally, on Palm Sunday, we'll be looking at the question, how could a loving God allow so much suffering? Palm Sunday is the perfect Sunday for us to look at that particular question. And then I did make a change. At the bottom of that, it says recommended books for further reading. If you have an interest in any of these subjects, these books are written primarily for lay people, and they will help you get a deeper sense, a deeper understanding for these questions. And I have relied on them in formulating some answers for us to look at. And one thing I did add on the bottom, it says great website for the intersection of faith and science. If you have an interest in science, in creation, how it all fits together, there's a website called biologos.org. Biologos.org. And the website is on your handout. And I encourage you to go there. It is full of just wonderful research. It is very orthodox in what it teaches regarding the Christian faith. And some of the leading scientists of our day are authors of the articles that are on there. So I just wanted to make sure that you were aware of that. You can look that up. And I want you to know that I've turned off all cell service in this room during the sermon, so you're not able to look that up at this time. Okay. So, hasn't science disproven Christianity? You may have heard of a movement out there in the world today that's known as the New Atheism. And New Atheism is a term that describes the positions of some writers, scientists, academics, and philosophers in the 20th and 21st centuries. And they are there are some very well-known figures within this movement, four of them in particular. They're known as the Four Horsemen of Atheism, right? Because they're trying to make fun of the four horsemen of the apocalypse, which you find in Scripture. And these are well-known writers: Richard Dawkins, Sam Harris, Christopher Hitchens, and Daniel Dennett. And these men have written many books over the years. They've sold millions of copies. Maybe you're familiar with their work. Maybe you've read some of their essays in their books. And they're interesting, right? They're good things to read and good things to learn about. And they essentially advocate that any view of superstition or any view of religion or irrationalism should not simply be tolerated, but rather it should be criticized, it should be countered, it should be examined, and it should be challenged, and it should be extinguished through rational argument. Now, since the time of the Enlightenment, the Enlightenment was in the 17th and 18th centuries, people have been trying to draw a hard dichotomy between science and faith. During the Enlightenment, ideas concerning God, reason, nature, and humanity were synthesized into a specific worldview that gained wide assent in the West, and it instigated revolutionary developments in art and medicine and philosophy and politics. And while much good came out of the Enlightenment, right, you're living in one of them, right? The United States of America is a product of the Enlightenment. Other items came out of the Enlightenment that weren't so good. Strong arguments against the Christian faith. The problem is that these arguments can be countered, but most Christian people don't know enough about their own faith. They don't know enough about the Scripture. They don't know enough about a Christian worldview to counter these arguments. Right? And so that prevailing view begins to be paramount within a culture. In our time, right, the biggest charges that people bring against the Christian faith, there's many of them, but there's three in particular. They'd say, I struggle with the Christian faith because of these three particular things. And those are creation, evolution, and miracles. Those are the big three. Okay. And I think this is in your bulletin insert if you're trying to follow along. While there are many questions that people in the science community have concerning the idea of believing in Jesus, these are the three primary ones that come. So in order to understand the place of science today, and I need to be honest about something here. I do not have a rich scientific background. Some of you do. We have scientists in this room. We have physicians in this room. We have people that have worked in that field for many years, and you know these topics much better than I do. My hope today is not to counter every single argument that's out there, but to give you a background in how science is actually rooted, it's rooted in the Christian faith. So, to hear arguments from the new atheists today, it's difficult to think that modern science was actually first developed by Christian people. And there's some names in your handout, and I just want to walk through some of these names with you to give you an idea of the richness of the Christian faith in the scientific tradition. There were two Franciscan friars, right? It means they come from the order of St. Francis of Assisi. Roger Bacon, who lived in the 13th century, as well as William of Ockham, who lived in the 13th and 14th centuries. And they laid the empirical and methodological foundations for the modern scientific method. Right? These were devout men of God who loved Jesus deeply. Francis Bacon, who lived in the 16th and 17th centuries, established and popularized the methods that the other two men put forward. And in his essay of Atheism, Francis Bacon writes, "It is true that a little philosophy inclineth man's mind to atheism, but depth in philosophy bringeth men's minds about to religion." Right? That is, the less you know, the more you're drawn to atheism, but the more you learn about the natural world, the more you will be drawn to faith in God. Robert Boyle, who lived in the 17th century, has his name forever memorialized in Boyle's Law. Anybody remember learning about Boyle's Law when you were in school? I see some hands going up around the room. It states, the absolute pressure exerted by a given mass of an ideal gas is inversely proportional to the volume it occupies if the temperature and amount of gas remain unchanged within a closed system. Now, I majored in history, and that means nothing to me, but I think it's pretty important, all right? Boyle was actually a devout Christian, heavily invested in evangelism, in Bible translation work. He actually considered becoming a minister, but decided that he would be able to serve Jesus more fully as a scientist. So, is it a coincidence, right, that the modern scientific method was first devised by Christian people? Historic Christianity prized the life of the mind. Oftentimes today we hear about the dumbing down of America, right? We also hear about the dumbing down of the church, where people don't know what it is they truly believe. They don't know to whom it is they truly belong, and they don't know why any of that even matters. But Christianity has a rich, rich history of elevating and celebrating the life of the mind. Medieval monasteries were centers for academic study. Indeed, the first universities emerged from a need to train priests for the church. Oxford and Cambridge, two ancient universities in England, were the first modern universities, so to speak. And then later, two universities following the very same tradition were planted in the United States during the colonial period, Harvard and Yale. And these were all founded on explicitly Christian ideals and teachings. The modern university, as we know it, was founded at Oxford in 1096 AD. That's before the First Crusade launched in 1099. Early modern Europe was not only a place of intellectual pursuit, though. China and parts of the Islamic world were in some ways more technical and more advanced, and they contained valued academic study. But they did not study in the same manner as the European institutions did, Oxford and Cambridge, because the scientific method came out of these institutions. Science is essentially, in a very basic definition, the study of seeking natural causes for natural phenomena. Of course, science has many branches, and it gets incredibly complicated, but at its most basic form, science is the study of seeking natural causes for natural phenomena. And it was Christians who were living in absolute wonder of the world in which God had created who instituted the rigorous systematic endeavor that builds and organizes knowledge. Many of the most famous scientists that we learned about in school, and I knew all these names, by the way, were people of a sincere faith in God. Isaac Newton is one of the most influential scientists of all time. Now, while he was not an Orthodox Christian, he loved God deeply and held a very special place in his heart for God's work in creation. And in fact, Isaac Newton wrote more on theology than he ever did on physics. And this is the man who formulated the laws of gravity and motion. Michael Faraday, that's a name from the 18th, 19th centuries, is best known for his work on electromagnetism. And his scientific contributions were so significant that he was considered the greatest experimental scientist ever. The Faraday constant, the Faraday effect, the Faraday cage, and Faraday waves are all named after him. And I learned about them by watching The Big Bang Theory on television. All right. Faraday was a passionate follower of Jesus and was deeply interested in the intersection of faith and science. James Clerk Maxwell lived in the 19th century, has been credited with the second unification of physics, bringing together electricity, magnetism, and light. He was an evangelical Presbyterian and actually was an elder in the Church of Scotland. Lord Kelvin, from whom we get the name of the Kelvin unit of temperature, is another example of scientific excellence and very serious faith. He was one of the first scientists to calculate the age of the earth in millions of years rather than in thousands of years. Well, one of the big things that the scientific world likes to push on the church because of creation is the Big Bang Theory. Is everybody, now, I'm not talking about the show. Has everybody heard of the Big Bang Theory? Right. Well, the Big Bang Theory was actually construed, put together by a cosmologist who was a Belgian Roman Catholic priest named Georges Lemaître, and I'm sure I tore his name apart. But he was the first to propose the idea that the universe had begun as an incredibly hot, incredibly dense point, which at some point collided together, creating a big bang. It almost sounds exactly like Genesis 1, doesn't it? And God said, boom! Stephen Hawking, in his best-selling book, A Brief History of Time, admitted that the Big Bang Theory smacks of divine intervention. George Mendel was a Roman Catholic friar, an Augustinian monk, who was attributed with the modern study of genetics after studying heredity in pea plants. And if you have any more interest in learning about the Christian pursuit of science, I encourage you to read the three books that I have on here on the handout. One is, Can a Scientist Believe in Miracles? An MIT professor answers questions on God and science. The Reason for God by Tim Keller. And Confronting Christianity, 12 Hard Questions by Rebecca McLaughlin. Excellent source of background information on science. And for you younger people, right? Rebecca McLaughlin also wrote a book called 10 Questions Every Teen Should Ask and Answer About Christianity. It's the same type of topics, but it's written at a little bit different level. On the handout, though, I put a website address, www.biologos.com. BioLogos was a group that was created by Dr. Francis Collins, who led both the Human Genome Project during President Bill Clinton's presidency, but he was also head of the National Institutes of Health. And it just so happens that Francis Collins is a committed, devoted follower of Jesus. He also wrote a 2006 best-selling book, The Language of God. Okay. So BioLogos. BioLogos is now a significant organization explaining how the natural world works with the biblical witness. And these are all great sources of learning that helps to refute the charges that the atheistic, scientific, and philosophical world level against Christianity, yet they can't handle the responses that typically come back at them. Many of the people who write for BioLogos and many people, let me back up just a moment. What I've learned over the last several months of reading and inquiry is that some of our finest universities in this nation, in the science departments, they are staffed with deeply committed Christian people. These are people who teach sciences. These are doctors in hospitals. These are people who work in private research firms. And what I've learned about them is that very few of them were actually raised in the Christian faith. Most of them were raised by their parents to be either agnostic or to be atheist in their worldview. And what's happened with them is as they entered into the study of natural sciences, as they've seen, as they've committed themselves to deep study of the natural world, they were drawn inexplicably into faith in God, the creator of all. The fingerprints of the creator are all over his creation. Okay. So Matt read from the 38th chapter of Job this morning. This is a text where God is rebuking Job after the terrible suffering that he has been undergoing throughout the first two-thirds of the book. And Job is lashing out at God. He wants an answer. He wants an explanation. He wants to know why these things happen to him. And what does God say to him in return? Where were you when I laid the earth's foundations? Tell me if you can understand. And he goes on to say, can you bind the chains of the Pleiades? Matt mentioned to the children this morning about looking up at the stars in the sky. Can you loosen Orion's belt? Can you bring forth the constellations in their seasons or lead the bear with its cubs? That's another constellation. Do you know the laws of the heavens? Can you set up God's dominion over the earth? And I chose that text this morning because when Job challenges the sovereignty of God, the first place that God goes to proclaim his power over creation is to point to creation itself. How it works, how it moves, how it couldn't possibly have happened by chance. This is the very place where faith and science meet head on. Our second reading for this morning, I know Isaiah has been waiting patiently for this for many minutes, is from Matthew 28, 16 to 20, and it's a brief scripture. But this is the Great Commission. And you may wonder, what in the world does the Great Commission have to do with science and faith? Well, let's read it. At this time, Jesus has been alive on the earth for 40 days. He's preparing to ascend into heaven bodily, and we read, Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshiped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age." This text reveals something to us that is worthy of our consideration this morning. Within the academy today, right, institutes of higher learning, there is a pervasive worldview that C.S. Lewis referred to as chronological snobbery. How many of you have heard of chronological snobbery? Yeah, this is an argument that the thinking, the art, and the science of an earlier time is inherently inferior to that of the present, simply by virtue of its timeline priority, or the belief that since civilization has advanced in certain areas, people of earlier periods were simply less intelligent, right? People of today are smarter than people of the ancient world. That's chronological snobbery. Matthew shares in the text. Remember, Matthew is an eyewitness. He was there. He is one of the disciples of Jesus. He shares that he and 10 other disciples, remember, Judas Iscariot has died. These are the hand-picked men of Jesus himself who have been with Jesus day in and day out for 3 years. They have been physically present for his teaching, for his preaching, his pastoral care, his miracles, his raising people from the dead and curing incurable diseases. They were with him in the upper room at the Last Supper and in the Garden of Gethsemane when he had been arrested. They'd seen Jesus present himself by passing through an empty door on Easter day. They'd seen this resurrected man eat solid food and present himself to more than 500 people. And some of those closest friends of Jesus struggled to believe what was before them. Some doubted. Now, this passage shows us several things, and I'm trying to wind this down for us this morning. It's a warning. It's a warning for us not to think that only we modern scientific people have to struggle with the idea of the miraculous, while ancient and more primitive people did not. The apostles responded like any group of modern people would if they were there that day. Some believed their eyes, and some did not. It's also an encouragement to patience. All of these men would become leaders in the early church. They would disperse throughout the Near East and Mediterranean world, and every single one of them except John would die as a martyr of the faith, never recanting who Jesus was and what he had done. May all of us who struggle with belief, whether it be for scientific reasons or for some other reasons, be open to the working of the Holy Spirit in our lives. And may we all learn to be at peace and know that science does not contradict faith, but rather adds to the depth and richness of it. Amen. Okay. I invite you, as you're able, to please rise at this time as we confess the faith of the church with two questions from the Westminster Shorter Catechism. Question 9, what is the work of creation? Question 10, how did God create man? Amen. Please remain standing for our closing praise. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship and community of the Holy Spirit be with you all, now and forever. And all God's children said, amen.